When it comes to technology, there is no one way or best way. When it comes to space technology, a stage rocket works fine without aerospikes. However, single-stage-to-orbit rockets, especially those that will operate on different worlds like Mars, Titan and Callisto, will definitely benefit from aerospikes. Not only this, but any other engine operating in a vacuum is bound to benefit from aerospikes. But what exactly is it? An aerospike is a type of rocket engine in which exhaust is vented along a curved surface on the outside of the engine instead of going through an open nozzle. The main issue that aerospikes are meant to deal with is that any fixed nozzle will have optimal performance at only one pressure. Everywhere else, the nozzle will be overexpanded at high pressure or underexpanded at lower pressure. A vacuum nozzle will do just fine when the rocket lands on the moon. However, if the rocket lands on Titan, where the surface pressure is 1.5 times that of Earth's atmosphere at sea level, and fires one of these, the instabilities could destroy the whole ship. SpaceX's Starship has three vacuum raptors and three sea level raptors. The combination of these two raptors is great in most environments. The vacuum raptors can be used to go into orbit during the second stage fire or onto Mars and the Moon. The sea level raptors can be used for control and on Titan. But what happens when the sea level raptors are too big for Titan? Is there a way to build a large nozzle that would perform properly at all pressures? Rocket function has been greatly improved by rocket scientists. A rocket's capabilities can be greatly improved by just a few percent difference. Based on the afterburner effect, a solution was developed. A jet engine can only operate in an atmosphere. Because of this, the afterburners were developed specifically for jet engines. Unlike rockets, jet aircraft do not carry their oxidizers. However, both the rockets and the jet aircraft carry their fuel. But the difference is that a jet pulls its oxygen from the air. For jet aircrafts on Titan, they will carry oxygen tanks only and pull their fuel from the air. But how is that possible? The atmosphere of Titan is mostly methane. This will burn perfectly well when combined with some oxygen. Jet engines have a compressor that pulls in air and compresses it before it goes into the combustion chamber. They mostly use rotating blades and stationary blades. Fuel is injected into the compressed air and ignited. The hot gas produced forces its way past the blades, causing some of them to spin while others remain stationary. Fluid dynamics is a completely different type of science, and this is how it works. The compressor is comprised of rotating blades and stationary blades. The rotating blades at the front of the jet engine spin and impart kinetic energy into the air. This in turn presses it forward and compresses it. However, the gas would start rotating with the blades, which in turn would reduce the effectiveness of compression. This is where the stationary blades come in. They stop that rotation so that the air can be compressed more by the next set of rotating blades. This whole process converts kinetic energy into high pressure. The part where the fuel is introduced is called the fuel burner. The hot expanding gas imparts kinetic energy to the rotating blades. These rotating blades are connected to a shaft, which then transfers the kinetic energy absorbed to the back to provide power to the compressor at the front of the engine. Generally, that's how a jet engine works. The stationary blades at the back prevent gas rotation from reducing engine efficiency. The gas expansion and pressure are converted into kinetic energy. This momentum of the gas moving through the engine and out the back is what creates the thrust that pushes the jet forward. When a jet aeroplane is flying through the air and has reached the limit of its thrust ability, extra fuel is added behind the usual fuel burner, which ignites when it comes into contact with the hot gas, thus adding extra thrust. This is what is known as the afterburner. Afterburners generally improve the power produced by a jet engine. However, this comes at an expense of reduced efficiency. A similar system can be used in large rocket engine nozzles to prevent overexpansion at low altitudes. How does this work? At sea level, optimized engines work great at takeoff. But the higher the rocket goes, the more it suffers from underexpansion and, eventually, starts to lose efficiency. This leads to fuel being wasted and reducing the payload to orbit capacity. For a vacuum-optimized engine of the same type, everything is the same except for the size of the nozzle. This way, it will be more efficient at high altitudes with low pressure, but if fired at sea level, the outside air will work its way into the engine and cause exhaust flow separation due to a pressure mismatch. This will cause turbulence and can even lead to the destruction of the engine. Elon Musk recently explained why SpaceX can test the vacuum Raptor engine at sea level without worrying about any instabilities. He said that the pressure under which the Raptor operates, which is about 230 bar during normal operation, with a maximum of 330 bar, is so high that there is no danger of critical overexpansion. This shows that the vacuum Raptor nozzle is not squeezing every bit of efficiency it can out of the engine. SpaceX decided that the mass penalty of a large nozzle was not offset by the increase in efficiency that the larger nozzle would provide. Elon said that the efficiency of the combustion process is very close to the theoretical maximum. This is due to the extremely high pressure in the combustion chamber. However, this does not mean that there is no room for improvement when converting that combustion efficiency into thrust efficiency. Many people have fallen into the trap of assuming that SpaceX's way is the only way and that there might be no better way to do something. They forget that they should always be open to the possibility of error. Elon follows this philosophy. When he was starting to build the Starship, he thought that carbon fiber would be the best choice of material. However, he was wrong. He paid dearly for this mistake when he realized that the rocket mass had increased and the complexity and mass of carbon construction and the expense offset the benefits. He noticed that as the mass of the Starship increased, the relative structural mass of steel components dropped. Putting into account that steel has a much higher heat resistance, there was a place that as rockets got bigger, steel would be the best choice over carbon fiber. He did not make the mistake of sticking with his first choice, not wanting to admit that he might have been wrong. Elon changed everything and started building the Starship using cookware steel. Besides aerospike engines, rocket scientists have thought of other solutions. What if instead small afterburners were installed in a ring around the nozzle? Then at low altitude, extra fuel and oxygen were injected. This would ignite and the pressure from the exhaust plume would create a virtual nozzle. The flight computers would then be used to adjust the ejection mass propellant flow so that it could stay optimized at every altitude. When the ship reaches a vacuum, it can be turned off and the main nozzle can be used. This would work very well and it would make it possible to use hydrogen with less efficient fuels like RP1 to improve performance even more. What could be done about a thrust augmented nozzle? Going back to the Deltaclipper, we can make an Ultraclipper. We can increase the size of the original DCX by 5 times. We can increase the height to 60 metres from 12 metres and the width to 20.5 metres from 4 metres. This would make it bigger than the Starship's second stage. As the ship gets bigger, the structural mass of propellant mass ratio drops. If we use bigger engines like the RS-68, which produces about 3,000 kilonewtons, then we would require at least 12 of them, which would be as efficient as the TL-10A vacuum engines with an efficiency of 465.5 seconds in a vacuum and about 400 seconds at sea level to have a thrust-to-weight ratio of about 1.25. As length and width go up by 5, the surface area goes up by 25 and the volume by 125. This ship would be an elongated pyramid whose volume would be about 8,405 cubic metres. The oxidizer propellant mass of hydrolock systems with an optimum oxidizer to fuel ratio of about 4 would be 330 kilograms per cubic metre. Assuming 500 cubic metres for payload area and crew area, 405 cubic metres for the engine bay, there remains a propellant volume of 7,500 cubic metres. This would eventually give us a mass of 2,475,000 kilograms of propellant. Because of the steel, the Starship has a dry mass that is 10% of the propellant mass. Using the same numbers, the dry mass will be 247,500 kilograms, which is a little more than twice the size of the Starship. Since we have twice the propellant mass, we would have an initial mass of 2,722,500 kilograms, excluding payload. On launching this thing without the payload, it would have a delta V of 10,582 meters per second. This with the assumption of the average specific impulse of 450 seconds. We can use 9,400 of that to get to low Earth orbit and an orbital velocity of about 7,800 meters per second. But this would mean losing the rest to aerodynamic and gravity drag. We should be able to get 100 tons into low Earth orbit. We can achieve this by releasing the payload, then burning a little delta B to get us back into the atmosphere, where air friction will help us slow down. This will help us land base first, entering at an angle of 6 degrees and firing the engines briefly to create a plasma shield. The side of the ship has an area of 615 square meters, while the base is a little more than 420 meters. We will make sure we present the broadest surface area to the airflow as we come down, then flip and land using what's left of our propellant at the last minute, just like the Starship. We could make everything work just as planned, then we would have a reusable single-stage-to-orbit spaceship that would be capable of getting 100 tons into low Earth orbit. This is not even close to being better than the Starship. The Starship will transport 150 tons into low Earth orbit. On Earth, single-stage-to-orbit ships with 900 seconds of specific impulse or less are not a viable option. But in any other worlds that will be visited, this will work just fine. Let's do some maths. Ignoring the atmospheric drag included in freefall, the minimum delta V required to get into low Mars orbit is about 4,100 meters per second. Taking our empty Ultraclipper with a mass of 247.5 thousand kilograms, 2,475,000 kilogram of propellant and 200,000 kilogram of payload, we would have an initial mass of 2,922,500 kilograms. Launching from the surface of Mars to low Mars orbit would require burning 1,768,200 kilograms of propellant, leaving the new mass at 1,154,300 kilograms. It can be docked from a ship from Earth, offloaded 200 tons of cargo, and load 200 tons of cargo for Earth. Our mass would still be the same. Since we would burn the propellant landing back on Mars, we would end up with an empty mass of 247.5 tons and 200 tons of cargo, with a little over 8 tons of propellant left over. In contrast, the methane-fueled Starship would only do the same from Mars with about 28,000 kilograms worth of payload. This is primarily due to the fact that the Starship uses a booster on Earth and returns empty-handed. There is no booster on Mars, and bringing things down from orbit will be important. A Starship's specific impulse is approximately 22.5% less than that of a Hydrolox rocket. If it's launched with no payload, Starship can bring back more and can also reduce the landing delta V requirement by using terminal velocity. The Ultraclipper can also do this. Among other things, SpaceX uses methane because it can be easily produced on Mars and it is easier to store. In addition to this, it is denser, hence reducing ship volume. This plays an important role when it comes to thicker atmospheres. Once a colony is established on Mars with its thin atmosphere, steel production and water for hydrogen processing, a hydrogen-powered Ultraclipper would be a better option. The Starship can bring passengers and cargo from Earth, and the Ultraclipper can meet it in orbit and bring it back home. So what do you think of the Ultraclipper? Do you think that it would be better to use the Starship? Let us know in the comments section below. Remember to like this video, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell button to get notified of new videos. Until next time, bye.